India for 20 years and continues to shepherd the movement. He is very involved with several developmental institutions, in particular in sectors such as drinking water, sanitation, disability, livelihood and education, which he feels very deeply for. He's also on the board of advisors for several artisan and craft groups such as, and we're very grateful that we have him as an advisor and artisans as well. Thank you so much. This was a talk that was initially given as the Kamala Devi Chattopadhyay Memorial Lecture in 2014. And when I read just the title, Can the Future Be Handmade? I felt that this is something that's very important for us to learn about, to think about and to care about. So with that, Professor Ashok Chatterjee, thank you very, very much for being here.
Thank you, Ravi. I'm not quite sure about that distinguished fellow business, but you can make up your mind here in this lecture. Thank you for being here. Thank you for inviting me to be here. Because just walking through from the yacht club here and passing through what is happening at Kalabora, one gets a little of a feel of what we're talking about today. There's so much that you see along that road, along the footpath, until you come to artisans. Our artisans making things by hand. Almost none of those crafts that you see on that pavement are quote unquote recognized crafts of the government of India. I don't know if you saw that man making wonderful wire sculptures, for example. And women putting together all kinds of interesting things with scrap material. None of those count as far as India's official policy on craft is concerned. But what we're talking about are people working by hand. This is the second largest industry in India after agriculture. The second largest industry. And yet, as of February 12, 2015, nobody in the government of India or outside the government of India has any idea how many artisans we have in this country, what they're earning, what they're contributing to the economy. It's a blank. Hopefully, in a couple months, that blank will not be quite as blank as it is now. Because as a result of civil society pressure, we were able in 2012 to have artisans included for the first time in the economic census, for the first time since independence. Now the economic census only counts people who have economic establishment, who work in a particular industry for 180 days or more per year. So those people won't be counted, perhaps. They have to take their products to market themselves. They have to be an economic establishment. So many of these artisans who don't go to the market themselves, but whose products are moved through other channels, they don't get counted in the economic census. But already, as of about a month ago, the Ministry of Statistics is sharing some absolutely extraordinary information that the Government of India's estimates, which used to vary from 6 to 13 million artisans, according to a particular list of crafts, and I'll come to that a little later. But now we're going to figures of 70 million, 173 million, 200 million. We still don't know. So it's a gray area,
But the broad outlines of this are emerging. And what is also emerging is that whoever the census counts are not just artisans. They are artisan entrepreneurs. And that changes the complete concept of the artisan, who is often dismissed as poor, neglected. Yes, they are, many of them are poor, they are neglected, but they're never respected as entrepreneurs. And yet that's what they are. So, as the saying goes, because we are like that only, which other country in the world would have the second largest industry without any basic data on it at all? Welcome to Bali. Whereas the IT industry, which in numbers is 2 to 3 million, we can get all the information like that. So, the title for this talk, Can the Future Be Handmade? Let me tell you, this is a slogan, and the slogan does not come from the Crafts Council of India, it comes from the European Union. It's a slogan that was coined in the European Union about 7 years ago. So does that tell us something about what we may have neglected, which the rest of the world is acknowledging? We have this huge Indian advantage, which is today in crisis. What is the crisis? The crisis is that the raw material for crafts are disappearing as we destroy our forests and our natural resources. The crisis is we don't have an organized marketing system for these entrepreneurs, for these products. And as you know, without organized marketing, nothing can succeed. Women who represent 50% of the workforce in the craft sector are not counted, are not invisible. Nobody gives them credit, but they do 50% of the work. Because our natural resources are disappearing, because people are being forced to move away from agriculture, many of our so-called rural crafts now come out of urban slums, including right here in Bombay. Right? So what does that mean? Because every time we have a craft made out, we go all rural. But many, many artisans today are not rural, they're urban. So there's a whole list of crises. Unfortunately, there are also some silver linings which we'll share. But let me give you an idea of a crisis that we went through about 2.5 years ago. How many of you here are wearing handloom fabric? Okay? Good. Is there something special about wearing handloom fabric?
Yes.
Okay. The garment industry, the fashion industry, both in India and overseas, I'm sure our friends from Lyft will confirm this, consider India's handloom fabric to be the greatest fabric in the world. And they don't make a distinction between handloom and khadi, but this kind of fabric, hand-woven in India to a scale which is not done anywhere else in the world, is considered the world's greatest fabric. And that greatness is applied by hand. 3 years ago, less than 3 years ago, the government of India sent out a circular to all the state governments to say that a 4-horsepower motor should be attached onto handlooms, thus converting all handlooms into power looms. So what happens to this great fabric? It's gone. As you know, it's hard enough for us to know which is a power loom fabric and which is a handloom fabric, but people in the business do know. And the whole idea is to create demand for the value addition of the hand gets. This decision was taken by the very department set up by Kamaladevi Chattopadhyay, in 1952 to protect the beaver. Development Commissioner of Handles, Government of India, Ministry of Textiles, sends out a directive that a four-house farm mortars to be attached to hand looms. And why? To improve productivity, apparently, to improve earnings, and as a gesture of support to the weaver. So the gesture of support to the weaver was to kill the khasit of their craft in one stroke and reduce them to power loom weavers. Now the power loom lobby, the power loom is the largest sector of textile manufacturing in India. The Ministry of Textiles has three sectors to look after. One is the mill sector, which is now very small compared to power loom. 60% is power loom, the rest is hand loom. We discovered that an election was coming up, and the power loom lobby had offered support to politicians if they would change the definition of hand loom to say that if only one process was done by hand, it was hand loom. So if you take a power loom and you put a little bit of zani on it, it becomes hand loom. Why? Well, number one, you would kill the hand looms. Number two, you would get concessions given to hand looms, so now they are given to the power looms. Go back, the 12th five-year plan, we are now in the 12th five-year plan, was developed with a very strong and very robust consultative process with civil society, both for hand looms and for handicrafts. At no point was this proposal shared with any of us who represented any of the organizations that participated in the development of the 12th plan. It was done with stealth. Fortunately, there was one extraordinary woman in the planning commission who rang us up to say, I don't know anything about this business, but something tells me that a hand loom means a hand. And there's a proposal on my desk that motors are to be attached to hand looms. And so, as the saying goes, the ship hits the sea. This is an important thing, particularly with Justin sitting here, that civil society without money, without political clout, working together in every part of the country, was able to stop this nonsense. And those motors never got attached. Those of you who know handlooms will know that the technology group for handlooms is the Weaver Service Center Network throughout the country. They were never consulted in this. But it indicated that at the top levels of planning and of decision making, the artisan does not count. The craft does not count. The homework is not done. And although there are these millions, they are invisible. They don't go on strike. They don't block highways. They don't stop railroads. So they are not a lobby, an organized lobby, and they are unheard. 2 weeks ago, we've been congratulating ourselves, we've been able to achieve this victory. And then the government changed. So we thought, oh God, now we have to start all over again. And do we ever have to start all over again? Because 2 weeks ago in Tamil Nadu, one of the most progressive states of handloom production, the Secretary of Textiles said, it would be a good idea to attach motors to handlooms. So now, the whole matter starts all over again. Attitudes have not changed. But the importance of this is that how on earth did we get here? Because during the worst years of the international recession, and we're still not completely out of it, the export of Indian handlooms and handicrafts has gone straight up in every part of the world. So why kill an Indian advantage? There's no logic for this, except that about 4 years ago,
two senior people in the government of India declared that the crafts represent a sunset sector. The implication of calling it a sunset sector is, let it die quietly, let the sun sink. And why? Because craft and hand activity is not compatible with India's global position as a world power. That this was something old hat, not modern, nice for museums, but nothing to do with modernity. So does that give us a key? This is where we started getting worried, because we couldn't understand how in Gandhiji's country someone could say the craft was a sunset activity. We take it for granted. And maybe that's our problem. We take this for granted. When we started discussing this to find out why this was to be a sunset industry, considered a sunset industry, all these attitudes started to fall onto the table. The lack of data, no data. Why should we invest in the sector? We don't know anything about it. Why don't you know anything about it? Don't know. We've never counted. The Crafts Council of India, which is a small NGO, then got a grant from the Tata Trust here in Bombay, and we conducted over a year and a half two studies, one in Kutch and one in Tamil Nadu, to demonstrate how a basic statistical base for the sector might be designed and conducted. I mean, an NGO was asked to do that. And we had no experience in economics of any kind, which is our fault. We should have been, but we didn't. But we were told, quite frankly, by the government of India, that no one else will do it. If you don't do it, don't do it. There was this census coming up. So we said, let's try. We did. We produced a system, tested it in Kutch and Tamil Nadu, took it to the ministries, took it to the Ministry of Statistics. They said, fine, this makes sense. And we were able to get artisans into the economic census. We had another challenge then, which was, how does a census enumerator know what is a craft and what is not a craft? Who do they count? Papad making, chutneys, pickles, beady rolling, is cooking a craft? We didn't have any answers to these. So we ended up in the Economic Census 2012 adhering to a list of crafts which have been recognized under the Development Commissioner Handicrafts and Development Commissioner Handmaids. And thereby hangs a tale. Because that list was developed in 1950s, when the first five-year plan came out, as a hobby list of crafts with an export potential. You might remember there was a gentleman called Mr. Manubhai Shah, at my age, who was the Minister of Commerce, and crafts was put under the Minister of Commerce as an export promotion activity. And today, the only robust data you can get for the craft sector is for exports. Our data is very strong. And therefore, the export lobby has been pushing the craft agenda from the very beginning. And many of the products that go out today under exports are not really made by hand. But that's not the story which we cannot develop. But I give you this background telling you that we have gotten to this mess